I'm going to be chairing the panel called AI and Global Intelligent Manufacturing in Smart City. Maybe I should need to introduce myself a bit so that the panelists know. I'm Vincent Yip. I'm an adjunct professor at Stanford, Berkeley, and Nanyang Technological University. The good thing about adjunct is that you don't have to be there full time, but the bad thing is you can get fired at any time. So I better not say anything wrong today. So Stanford, Berkeley, and to you. So can you please first introduce yourself, which city you are from, and say a bit about the manufacturing in your city, just from the start. Name, which city you represent, and what are the issues, what are the manufacturing activities in your city? First we start. Mr. Xu.
好，感谢主持人，感谢大家。我来自中国重庆渝北区信涛数据股。刚才主持人说到了重庆在制造业方面有一些什么样的产业以及什么样的布局，在这里我给大家说一组数据。重庆去年啊，2017年 GDP 大数做到了1.9万亿，工业产值大数超过了3万亿。在这个里面呢，我们称之为有四驾马车，各5000亿拉动了整个样的一个制造业的发展。其中第一个就是以汽车为代表的这个汽车产业，去年重庆啊，这个汽车一共生产了340万辆。这个数据相当于什么呢？相当于全球1/8的汽车就在重庆进行生产，这是第一个。第二的一个是笔记本电脑，去年重庆生产的笔记本电脑6000万台。这个数据的话，就说全球啊，有3台笔记本电脑，其中有一台就是重庆生产的。第三的一个就是以手机，以智能手机为代表的智能终端。去年重庆啊，生产智能终端3.5亿部，这个数据也占到了全球去年手机出货量的1/8。第四的一个呀，那就是以重型装备为代表的这个装备制造业，其中有轻轨，有地铁，都是重庆造。第二的一个，重庆还在生产着以皮拉图斯和恩斯托隆为代表的这个直升飞机，还有小型固定翼飞机。这四大块目前就是重庆的在制造业方面的一些布局。
That's very impressive. Cathy, we all know your city, but could you tell us a little bit about the manufacturing part?
Yes, of course. Well, as you know, we were talking about earlier, as I said earlier, Santa Clara, we consider it the center of what's possible. And one of the things that we've been able to do here is attract a lot of businesses. If you've driven around the city while you've been here, you may see Intel. We're home to the Intel headquarters, as well as NVIDIA. And NVIDIA is continuing to expand. There is Santa Clara Square, which is right about a mile down the road here on Great America Parkway, which has become home to AMD, and Analog Devices will also be relocating their headquarters to that location later this year. We're very fortunate to have a lot of data centers. Santa Clara actually has its own power company, its own utility company. And as a result, we're very fortunate in that we can attract a lot of business because of our low utility rates. So as a result, we have become home to a lot of data centers. You will also see if across the street, Levi Stadium, that's become another very big manufacturing outlet for our city. And you'll also probably have noticed Great America, an amusement park right down the street. Santa Clara is very fortunate, has always planned very wisely, and as a result, you know, we are, you know, seeing, we're reaping the rewards of that planning right now, and we're continuing to see that happen. So even right behind us, if I have the opportunity to talk about, I won't go too much into it right now, but we have the opportunity right now. You may have seen a golf course behind us here, but that's actually going to be turned into something else. So I'll just leave it at that for now. But Santa Clara is an exciting place to be these days, and I'm really proud to be able to represent it. So thank you for the question.
Thank you, Kathy. And next?
Yes, I'm Hui Xu from ChongQing Venture Capital. Our company just focuses on the venture capital and the covering manufacturing, biomedicine, and the extra high technology industry. So far, we have invested more than 100 companies, and we are managing more than 1.5 billion RMB. And so I'm so glad to come here to Silicon Valley and to Santa Clara. So, and the Mr. Xu mentioned some exact data of ChongQing in manufacturing. As an investor, I just want to share some philosophy of investing for us in AI and the intelligent manufacturing. We normally to judge which the industry in which status for especially AI and integrated with the traditional manufacturing. So far, we think that on the stage of only on technology. So we have a lot of technology problem need to resolve and find the suitable service or products can imply to the traditional manufacturing and help them to improve the efficiency of some manufacturing, and then we can discuss more about the business model and how to improve the efficiency or how to reduce the cost of the factories. So, so far our company just focus on the technology, some especially a key technology, how to help the traditional manufacturing in reduce the cost. And then you know the Silicon Valley have it's a hot base for the high technology, especially AI. So that's why we come here to want to look for some collaboration about venture capital to find the leading the technology I can bring to China and to help us to improve the efficiency. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Xinjian Zhou. I'm actually from the city of Santa Clara. My office is very close by, nearby, so on a Great American Parkway. So I used to work for a company called ASML. It's a Dutch company that makes lithography machine, which in turn manufacture silicon chips. Our office used to be a startup, uses computation modeling to improve the performance of the machines. So it was later acquired by ASML. And before I step out, we actually were running a very large project to improve the performance of their very top machines. But initially wanted to do computation, but gradually we kind of moved toward big data and artificial intelligence. That seems to be the best solution. So now I work for a unit called BICI, Beijing Institute of Collaborative Innovation. So we have an office here. So what we do is we identify promising early stage technology, connect them to industry users, and we invest and incubate. So for example, we were in Chongqing in the Xiantao data set valley. In January, we brought two professors from University of Michigan and we're talking with Chang'an Automobile Company, again, bring their algorithm into the production line, hopefully to improve the yield and lower costs. So that's what we do. Yeah, very nice meeting.
Thank you. My name is Yang. I come from UIS. We have more than 20 big science parks and industrial parks all over China. And this moment, we have one accelerators actually co-work with GSV Labs in Redwood City. So regarding to the questions from which cities, personally, I was from Qingdao, China. I spent 10 years in New York City, but I 5 months ago moved to Silicon Valley, but I'm more than happy to share what is going on to from our perspective to see the manufacturing, especially the smart hard devices. And we have more than 120 startups and companies in our ecosystems in UIS all over those million square feet industrial park, science park. Particularly, we have one that's in Chongqing Yubei district that is a very big accelerators, and that's 50 out of that 120 the startups in manufacturing smart devices are located in the accelerators as happens in Chongqing Yubei district. And I'm more than happy to share one great example, which is the smart speakers, the Xiaoai system. They're growing very fast in the past 3 years, sells millions of products, and they eventually got acquired by Xiaomi. So now Xiaomi almost gonna be IPO. I think it's probably another few days. In the past only 7 years, and that Xiaomi big ecosystems only focused the part of this smart devices, smartphones, smart home, and reaching to the valuation is $200 billion. So we see that they not just the big giant, the company such as Xiaomi, but also the Xiaoai, those small startups focusing the manufacturing, but in a different part, they actually make great contributions.
Harrison? Okay. Harrison, you have to be quick. Identify yourself, which city you represent, and what kind of manufacturing you're involved with.
Okay, my name's Harrison Rose. I'm a CEO and founder of Telepresence Robotics Corporation. We call it TRC. And I'm not associated with a specific city. What I'm associated with is the use of commercial robots with smart cities. Because to me, a robot is an extension of the information and communications technology into the real physical world. Think of it like a peripheral to the internet. And so if you can add the capability of expanding into the physical world what you're now doing with information and communications, this is going to be a major enabler to getting the best value and the most productive and the happiest customers in a smart city.
Okay, thank you very much. For the sake of time, because we have a lot of panelists now, I'm going to be directing questions, specific questions. Please be short, answer the question, do not give a general description, all right? Firstly, I've really written up some notes. The application of AI in manufacturing, I would like to break it down into three aspects. One is the labor saving aspect of it, which is the most popular. And then I want to talk about the safety part of it, the safety issue part of it. And then thirdly, the logistics, the supply chain part of it. Okay. Firstly, I'd like to direct it to our Chongqing, Mr. Xu. Yeah. I'm very familiar with Shenzhen. I'm originally from Singapore, which is the original smart city. And of course, it's useless now. It cannot make anything. It's too expensive. And Shenzhen took over from Singapore. And it's, right now, Shenzhen is losing some of its edge because of labor. It looks like it's going to Chongqing. Can you compare the wages between Shenzhen and Chongqing, the supply of labor, and what is the advantage you have, and how are you going to prevent yourself not becoming a Singapore or a Shenzhen? The labor rates, and what are you going to do as far as AI is concerned to prevent yourself becoming expensive again 20 years from now?
我这样子来回答这个问题，因为我在数据谷，我是分管产业的。因为刚才主持人讲到了，就是人工智能它如何在影响着这个两个这个区域位置也不一样，生活习惯也不一样，然后语言文化也不一样，同时在这个房价也有差异的。其实我们是这么来认识这个问题的：第一个，从技术的这个角度来讲，我先讲技术。因为人工智能啊，在沉寂了60年之后，它突然就在这3年爆发，其得益于三个维度。 第一个维度是基于大数据的发展，第二个维度是基于我们的计算能力的发展，第三的一个维度是基于现在我们的很多算法的发展。而在这个问题里面，重庆和深圳有些什么样的不一样？在这个技术这个领域里面来讲的话，这么一说大家就明白了。深圳现在做的事情，它是以创新为引领的人才集聚、信息流、物流、资金流集聚的这样的一个城市。重庆和深圳区别在于什么？重庆它也许不像深圳这样子有这样明显的三流汇聚的效应，但是正如我刚才所说的，重庆有自己和深圳比起来，深圳比不了的非常夯实的这个制造业的基础。而我们认为人工智能它也许像大数据一样不能作为一门独立的产业单独成之，因为它是一个技术领域。在这种情况之下的话，重庆反而是能为人工智能，不管是做大数据的、做运算能力的、做算法的团队和人员，提供着一个更具体的技术可落地的产业场景。这才是深圳、北京、上海、新加坡来自于海外的人才他会到重庆来落户的这样的一个机遇和契机。其次，再是主持人您刚才说到的，重庆作为全国中国的四个直辖市之一，我们的房价目前只相当于深圳房价的大概也就是1/8到10% 左右，所以这样子也是房价的一个洼地。但是我想提醒大家的是，其实真正吸引一个年轻人、优秀的团队到一个地方去来做一些体现自己人生价值的事情，他一定是他所学所用能够具体到和当地的一个产业环境相结合在一起，这样子对于个人的发展来讲的话才会是一个非常有益的事情。
好、very good. I'd like to add a bit because I'm very fond of the Silk Road and OBO, 一带一路 and Chongqing has a big advantage of being at the source of the 一带一路 which is not where Shenzhen or Beijing or Singapore is not quite part of it, so Chongqing has an advantage, so I'd like to add that point. Now, I'd like Cathy to talk about it because your wages are already very high, your real estate is extremely high, so can AI even help?You don't have much manufacturing anymore, right? So you're the source of AI. You are not using AI to help your manufacturing, right, Cathy?
No, you're absolutely right. But I think it was discussed earlier, or a comment was made about education. We need to start, teaching children, more, a lot earlier now. I mean, we have STEM, we have STEAM, and we need to make sure that that's integrated into our educational system to bring, to make sure that the students of today will be ready for tomorrow, to give them that ability to be able to continue to develop and AI or IoT, science, technology, give them those benefits because, if anybody's reading the paper or watching the news lately, the median price of a home in the valley right now is $1 million. And it's very disconcerting. And I have a 16-year-old daughter. I'm very concerned, for her future. But I think the best thing that we can do for our children is to make sure that they have the ability to learn right now, to give them the tools that will enable them, to continue to develop AI and give them the ability to have the kind of life that, they can be sustainable here and also and just continue to make this a better place for them all to live.
Okay, wonderful. It's a bit like, we're not talking about Apple, but NVIDIA, big company, important company, Intel, soon it will be like,design in Santa Clara, but used somewhere else. Yep. Okay, I'm going to quickly shift to the other two aspects. We're not going to talk about the same topic because we will run out of time. So I'm going to address the next two topics to the other three gentlemen, plus Harrison, which is on the safety and logistic point of view. Is it Dr. Zhou, right? Dr.
Zhou?
Yeah. Dr. Zhou, please tell us a bit about what your research and other things about the safety aspect of AI and the logistic part of AI. How is AI being applied and helping in these two aspects?
So I just read the news in the actually conference room that Cambridge Analytica just went bankrupt. So that proves that even if you breach the safety using your AI technology, whatever, you'll be out of business because you're not following ethic. So ethics is a big part of safety for AI. We do lots of projects with manufacturing companies. So over there is basically industrial AI or industrial IoT. So over there, indeed, companies guard their data secrecy, very high emphasis on that. So it's really hard to get data from customer side, so we have to bring our algorithm onto their servers. So I think for manufacturing, these are being taken well care of. But for a smart city, for a, especially for citizens, I do worry that we're being taken advantage of. So there should be a legislation effort to really to ban this type of activity and really punish them harshly.
Mr. Xu, can you speak something about safety and logistics? Of AI.
Yeah. Okay, and safety is a big issue for the AI in the manufacturing, and how to protect the people, because you know in China there is a much number of workers just in the manufacturing I think is one side is how to improve the ability of the labors so far, because and the second is who is pay the cost of the help the traditional manufacturing and use the AI technology. Who is pay the cost is a big problem. How to resolve the training and the case mentioned to improve the ability and how to pay the cost if, because we need to buy the water box or some software software and some, you know, get the financial support. Everything needs a cost. So I thought so far, maybe for the safety, we need, you know, the government to have the play a big role in the protect the ability of the workers and help the traditional manufacturing reduce the cost of the improve the use the AI technology.
Okay. I'm going to make Harrison work a little harder. Yes, because you are the robotics guy. So many robots are used in Tesla or whatever. Has the safety rate been improved? And what are the future? How are you applying AI in robotics in manufacturing? Okay.
My understanding is that the accident rate is continually going down because of the application of machine learning to the interactions of the robot with the working environment, the manufacturing. We have a couple of new companies that have blossomed into the marketplace that are now adding sensory technology systems at the outset, like such when you have arms swinging around doing things, they can detect if someone gets too close and will not hit them. Okay, this is, you know, the Baxter is the example of that. And they got some significant funding and they're making significant market share and they're making things safer in manufacturing. Similar things can apply in the smart city environment, which is outside of manufacturing. And that's where you may have a fleet of robots doing last mile delivery, which is part of logistics. And as those robots continue to gather data, then you can have the machine learning and artificial intelligence that exists in the cloud that's managing and interpreting this information to make better judgment calls and create new policies that increase its productivity, reduce its accident rate, and make things safer for everybody around. For an example, last mile delivery robots that would be able to bring a package from the grocery store or bring a package from a pizza parlor to you will be able to replace the accident rate that currently exists from people driving cars to deliver these packages. It's, we are already seeing the signs of this, but it has a substantial impact on the carbon footprint because now we're using electric vehicles to deliver without having the carbon footprint, and we are keeping them off of the congestion of the streets, even though they have very limited response. So most of these telepresence or these last mile delivery type robots can only go within 2 miles, and that's within half an hour. But that is a very large percentage of the deliveries, especially in large, in strong urban settings.
Okay, as the chair, I'm going to take the liberty of expanding the topic because this is the last one on smart city. I'm going to open it up to talk about AI application in smart city in any aspect, not just manufacturing. It could be on anti-terrorism, it could be on energy saving, it could be on pollution, it could be on transportation. So maybe we'll ask Mr. Yang, any of these topics, as long as it's AI and smart city, you can talk about it.
Yes, I think I would like to share one of the great examples we see in our ecosystem. So we have a...
Mr. Yang, put your microphone closer.
Yes, we have a startup in our ecosystem, TrueFace AI, which is from Silicon Valley. And they have almost the best facial recognition technology. But one big problem to TrueFace AI, to the founder of Sean, is they don't have so much data. And if you see like what's happening in China, is they just get all the cameras on the roads, in the buildings. So there's one big giant of the unicorn company in facial recognition with Face++. So our UIS help with the Sean from TrueFace AI to reach Face++, which Face++ founders also would like to get the top technology from Silicon Valley. But they have too much data, getting the data from China, which is the part of the Sean will be very interesting in this. So this great example is actually showing like, you know, in AI, it's not just about the computer programming. It's sometimes also about how you're collecting those data, how you analyze those data, and put the AI technology into an application. So that's one of the examples I'd like to share.
Okay, I was told to end, but I'm going to overwrite them. I'm going to give the last two answers to the two mayors, vice mayors. From Mr. Xu from Chongqing, please tell us overall, not just manufacturing, what are the AI applications in your city that you would like to tell us, which is not done in any other city in China or around the world? What are the AI applications that are different, special?
我这样子来回答这个问题。其实 AI 这个技术啊，它现在不只是说在重庆如何来应用的问题，而是说现在中国我们怎么样来迎接着大数据、人工智能这样的一个时代。所以在去年的12月8号的时候，我们中国的最高领导人在一次会上就专门说了一句，要通过大力的发展这个大数据产业，推动着数字中国的建设。在昨天我给有些嘉宾也讲到了，重庆啊也正在进行着数字城市的建设，其中呢，以渝北区为代表，渝北区正在做着一件事情，那么就是数字渝北会作为数字中国先行先试的这样的一个示范项目，一个国家级的示范项目。在这个里面呢，我用最后一分钟来回答刚才主持人讲到，就人工智能啊，现在在重庆已经有些什么样的应用，或者是即将应用到什么样的方面？其实是三个维度的问题。一个城市啊，它要进行自己的面向于数字化的改革，我们认为是三个维度。第一个，要服务于 数字政府，提高政府的办事效率，提高政府各个部门之间的协同能力，提高更好的服务，这是第一个维度，政府要实现数字化、智能化。第二个维度是服务于民生，就是服务于我们的老百姓。如何服务于我们老百姓，其实就是关注十二个字，我们老百姓的叫吃喝拉撒衣食住行生老病死。第三的一个，作为一个城市来讲，它必须要有产业作为支撑，所以 AI 的第三的一个大的应用范围，它一定就是服务于重庆现在目前的制造业以及一些新兴的产业。所以我用这三个维度来回答主持人的问题。
Okay.
谢谢。
Okay, 30 seconds for Kathy, since it's, we are in Santa Clara, we've got to give her the last word.
Thank you. I will keep it short. I think the best example that I can use of how artificial intelligence is being used here in Santa Clara is just right across the street at Levi's Stadium. It was built with a lot of smart technology and artificial intelligence. Two of the examples were created for the Super Bowl, which we hosted here 2 years ago, and one of them affects the intersections here in transportation. Smart technology was implemented to keep traffic moving a lot faster. And I've actually seen the screens, I can't tell you where they are, but I've seen the screens where they have the transportation intersection set up so they can direct traffic. They have an application, there's an application that's been created so that to give attendees, the fans, the best experience that they can have at a football game right from their seats. They have interaction, they can see the replays, they can order food from their seats. I mean, they've just made it very smart and to make the experience more enjoyable. And we do have a plan to, there's 240 acres behind us that's being developed to a Santana Row type facility development on, that we call it Santana Row on steroids, but we're looking to implement a lot of smart technology there to help parking, security, really implement and make it, not just a place to go, but to really make a smart place to go. So we're looking forward to developing that project.
Okay, with that, thank you very much. Thank you to the panelists. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.